Good evening, I'm Bill Moyers. What's more dangerous, the big stick or the big lie? Governments have used both against their own people. Tonight I'll be talking with a man who has been thinking about how we can see the developing lie. He says that propaganda is to democracy what violence is to a dictatorship. But he hasn't lost faith in the power of common people to speak up for the church.
So there are ways of compensating for the absence of resources. People can do things. Okay, the information is there, but it's there to a fanatic, you know, somebody who wants to spend a substantial part of their time and energy exploring it and comparing today's lies with yesterday's leaks and so on. That's a research job. And it's, you know, it just simply doesn't make any sense to ask the general population to dedicate themselves to this task on every issue. I'm not given to false modesty. There are things that I can do, and I know that I can do them reasonably well, including analysis and study, research. I mean, I know how to do that sort of thing, and I think I have a reasonable understanding of the way the world works as much as anyone can.
Yeah.
And that turns out to be a very useful resource for people who are doing active organizing, trying to engage themselves in a way which will make it a little bit of a better world. And if you can help in those things or participate in them, well, that's, you know, that's rewarding.
But the point is that you have to work. And that's why the propaganda system is so successful. Very few people are going to have the time or the energy or the commitment to carry out the constant battle that's required to get outside of, you know, McNeely Dan Rather or somebody like that. The easy thing to do, you know, you come home from work, you're tired, you've had a busy day, you know, you're not going to spend the evening carrying out a research project. So you turn on the tube and say, it's probably right. You know, or you look at the headlines in the paper and then you watch the sports or something. That's basically the way the system of indoctrination works. Sure, the other stuff is there, but you're going to have to work to find it.
I feel that I'm simply helping people develop courses of intellectual self-defense.
What did you mean by that?
What would such a course
be? Well, I don't mean go to school, because you're not going to get it there. It means you have to develop an independent mind and work on it. Now, that's extremely hard to do alone. You know, the beauty of our system is it isolates everybody. Each person is sitting alone in front of the tube. You know, it's very hard to have ideas or thoughts under those circumstances. You can't fight the world alone. Some people can, but it's pretty rare. The way to do it is through organization. So courses of intellectual self-defense will have to be in the context of political and other organization.
You have said that we live entangled in webs of endless deceit, that we live in a highly indoctrinated society where elementary truths are easily buried. Elementary truths such as?
The fact that the military system is to a substantial extent, not totally, but to a substantial extent, a mechanism by which the general population is compelled to provide a subsidy to high technology industry. Since they're not going to do it if you ask them to, you have to deceive them into doing it. I think there are many truths like that, and we don't face them.
And I think there are a number of pretty simple ideas that ought to define what the role of intellectuals ought to be. By intellectuals, I just mean people of relative privilege, training, resources, opportunity, an ability to be in a position where you can get involved in some fashion in affairs that matter to human beings. So it's intellectuals. It excludes, for example, a great scientist who just stays in his laboratory and, you know, wins his Nobel Prize. It excludes somebody who's working so hard putting food on the table that he just doesn't have time to think about these things. But it includes, in our societies like ours, a large group of other people. For example, anybody related to a university anyhow, because we have these privileges and opportunities. So that's roughly the category. I don't think that the role of people with some degree of privilege, say like us, should be to tell truth to power. One reason is power already knows the truth. You don't have to tell it to them. They understand it very well. That's why they're doing what they're doing. Another is that they're not the right audience. You should be reaching people who don't know the truth. Tell them. Furthermore, you shouldn't be telling them. It's not that we have some, you know, whoever it is, has some kind of magic authority. We have our own ideas. They have their ideas. In 1975, for example, the large majority of Americans, I think, knew the truth, that the war was not a mistake. It was fundamentally wrong and immoral. You didn't have to tell them the truth. You can participate with them in finding out the truth, learning it yourself, encouraging them to think it through for themselves. So you should be reaching out to other people, trying to learn the truth as best you can together with them. And it should be the audience that matters, not the powerful. And it should be on issues that are of significance. A couple of days ago, a trial ended in The Hague, the trial of Charles Taylor for terrible crimes in Sierra Leone. The case was narrower than what the prosecutors wanted. The prosecutors, who were, one of them is a distinguished law professor in the United States, the other a well-known barrister in London, they wanted a much broader case. They had collected, they claim, massive evidence to implicate Gaddafi in the crime. He'd been massively funding Taylor, participating, sending arms. So they wanted to broaden the case to include Gaddafi. Well, the U.S. and Britain blocked it. And the International Criminal Court, of course, takes orders from the masters. So they narrowed the case, and no mention of Gaddafi. And it's the normal pattern. The wrong kind of story must be marginalized and kept from the eyes of the public, and meanwhile we focus on the terrible crimes of others, like Charles Taylor in Sierra Leone. Now, it's pretty obvious why they wanted to cut Gaddafi out. He was a loyal friend and ally, so you don't want to implicate him. Well, now the story's changed, so you know, we talk about what we can do about this monster. That's, again, perfectly normal. To take just one last case, in the 1970s, Saddam Hussein was an enemy. That changed in the early 80s. In fact, in 1982, the Reagan administration decided that they wanted to provide arms to Iraq, to assist in their invasion of Iran. Well, there's a little impediment. There's an institution called the list of terrorist states, and Iraq was on the list of terrorist states. So the government had to remove Saddam from the list of terrorist states, and since there was a gap, they had to put somebody in, so they put Cuba in honor of the fact that Cuba had been the victim of really massive terrorism in the preceding several years. Shooting down an airliner, killing 75 people, blowing up embassies, all sorts of crimes. So they were put in on the terrorist list to replace Saddam, who came out. The next year, 1983, we had Donald Rumsfeld going to Baghdad, you know, shaking hands with his friend Saddam, entering into arms and other deals. This continued right through the 1980s. U.S. support for Iraq was so strong that Iraq was given a kind of a gift that no other country has except Israel. They were permitted to attack a U.S. ship and kill a couple of dozen sailors and get away with it with nothing but a weak apology. Nobody can do that except for Israel, which did it in 1967. But that shows real love. The U.S. essentially entered the war. The U.S. also denied Saddam's atrocities. That's the Halabja massacre, the Al-Anfal massacres of the Kurds, everything denied. In fact, the administration even intervened in Congress to prevent them from issuing a declaration of censure for these huge atrocities, the worst ones of Saddam's rule. And finally, the U.S. entered the war directly, and Iran capitulated. They couldn't face U.S. Participation in the war. love for Saddam continued after the war. In 1989, so that's a year after the war ended, the president was now President Bush, the first President Bush. He invited Iraqi nuclear engineers to the United States for advanced weapons training in nuclear weapons manufacture. That's 1989. A couple of months after that, President Bush sent a delegation to Iraq to convey his greetings to his friend Saddam. This was April 1990. The delegation was led by Senator Robert Dole. He was Senate Majority Leader, later Republican presidential candidate, other high-level senators. We have the transcript. They brought President Bush's greetings to Saddam. They assured Saddam that he could ignore some critical comment he was hearing in the American press. We have this freedom of press business, so we can't figure out a way to shut him up, but you can ignore them. And in fact, the White House assured Saddam that they would remove from the Voice of America, you know, the official international press service, eliminate a reporter who was being too critical of their friend. This was April 1990. A couple of months later, Saddam committed a real crime. He disobeyed orders, or maybe misunderstood them, it's not clear. And he invaded Kuwait. Okay, he suddenly became the reincarnation of Hitler. Saddam realized when he invaded Kuwait that he'd made a mistake, that he thought it could be authorized. He didn't understand. He saw right away he's in trouble. And then the discourse in the White House is interesting, which we also have. In the White House, they were concerned. Colin Powell, head of the Joint Chiefs, said the problem is that Saddam might withdraw and leave a puppet regime behind, and all the Arab states would be perfectly happy. And we can't allow that to happen, so we have to go to war and destroy Iraq. Well, if Saddam had been allowed to do that, he would have duplicated almost exactly what the U.S. had done a couple of months earlier, namely invaded Panama in order to kidnap a thug who had also disobeyed orders, brought him to Florida where he was tried for crimes that he committed while he was on the CIA payroll, installed a puppet government. About the only difference is the Latin American states weren't happy about it. They threw Panama out of the coalition of democratic states and so on. The deaths were also a little different. According to Human Rights Watch, tried to estimate it, when Saddam invaded Kuwait, there were about 800 people killed. According to Panamanian human rights groups, when the U.S. invaded Panama, there were about 3,000 killed. Now, we don't look at casualties that we cause. That's another thing that's off the record. So there's no Western confirmation of these calculations, but they could very well be right. American forces were bombing apartment houses and poor neighborhoods and so on. Well, that's not exactly the story the way it reaches us. It's only the story the way it happened all the way through. And that's, again, quite typical. It's like not mentioning the slightly embarrassing fact that the International Criminal Court absolved Gaddafi of the atrocities for which they just condemned Taylor, because he was a friend and an ally, like Saddam Hussein. This story just proliferates so far that it's almost pointless to give examples. It's hard to think of an exception. It's close to uniform. And that tells you something very significant about the role of intellectuals and their responsibility in the service of power, both in supporting atrocities and crimes and in reshaping the current scene and history so that it looks good for us, you know, for the powerful. This may be against the will of the public, as in the case of Vietnam, but it ends up being the picture that's transmitted to later generations. So it's what you read in school and so on. Ronald Reagan came into office in 1981 and declared that the core function of U.S. foreign policy would be to combat the plague of the modern age, return to barbarism in our time, namely state-supported international terrorism. That episode has kind of been disappeared from history, to borrow the Latin American transitive verb, disappear. It's been eliminated. Kind of wrong story, wrong agency, not the right kind of thing to remember. It goes back much before that. This war on the murder of the Jesuit intellectuals in 1989 terminated a long campaign of terror and brutality that started in the early 1960s. It started actually with Vatican II. Vatican II in 1962 was an attempt by the Pope, Pope John XXIII, to institute a really radical change in church history. As you probably know, he tried to restore the church of early Christianity, the Gospels, what they actually say, a message of radical pacifism, which is, of course, why the early Christians were persecuted. That changed in the 4th century when the Roman Empire took over the church, made it the church of the persecutors, not the church of the persecuted, in the phrase of distinguished theologian Hans Küng, one of those punished in the period of the 60s and 70s. He wasn't killed. He was just kind of kept from teaching and so on. He is lucky. In 1962, at Vatican II, the Pope declared an effort to return the church to its original mission, to be the church of the persecuted, a very significant change. And it was taken seriously, particularly in Latin America. The Latin American bishops adopted that program. They adopted what was called the preferential option for the poor, message comes out of the Gospels, and priests and nuns, lay persons, went to the countryside, tried to organize peasants into base communities where they would read the Gospels, think about ways to adopt measures to survive somehow in the extremely harsh domains of U.S. power. Now, that was a heresy that was not going to be tolerated. The U.S. very quickly launched a war against the church. The church and all social movements that were participating in these similar efforts. It began very quickly in 1964. A military coup took place in Brazil, overthrowing the civilian government that had actually been prepared by the Kennedy administration, carried out shortly after Kennedy's assassination. That established what was called a national security state, kind of a neo-Nazi style terror and torture state. And Brazil's a big country, a big influence. A plague spread through the hemisphere. Chile, Uruguay, Argentina, one country after another. Similar phenomena, plenty of religious martyrs because they were in the forefront. And it continued through Central America in the 1980s. Essentially terminated with the murder of the six Jesuit intellectuals in November 1989, right at the time of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Well, it's well known to scholarship that the terror and atrocities and brutality and slaughter in Latin America from 1960 to the end of the century were incomparably worse than anything that happened in Eastern Europe in those years. What happened in Eastern Europe was bad enough, but what went on in Western domains was incomparably worse. Now, that's known to scholarship. For example, you can read it in the recently published the Cambridge University History of the Cold War, kind of comment on it. But it's not known to the public. What's known to the public is the suffering of the East European dissidents, which was real, and they should be respected and honored. But in comparison with what was happening elsewhere, they were pretty lucky, far luckier than the Jesuits of El Salvador or the Archbishop or many others during those years. Well, the task, one of the task of intellectuals is to ensure that we know about the East European dissidents, and we pride ourselves on our heroism in supporting them, but we don't know about the ones who we slaughtered and tortured and killed. That's out of history, not to be remembered. I happened to be in Europe in November 2009 at the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall, and there was a great deal of euphoria, self-congratulation about our great courage in supporting dissidents in the enemy's domain, but there wasn't a word about what happened in Latin America, primarily carried out by the United States, but with the strong support of its European allies all the way through. Well, that's the typical task of the intellectuals. If you go back to, say, the Vietnam War, there was protest, substantial protest, mostly on the part of young people, students, people outside the elite intellectual circles. There was some protest there, but very muted and quite interesting in its character. I've written about it if you want the details. Up through the early years of the war, there was overwhelmingly strong support for the war, virtually no protest. In fact, support for the war was so strong that very few people, even today, know when the war began. It actually began just 50 years ago, in 1961. President Kennedy at the time, sent the American Air Force to start bombing South Vietnam, authorized the use of napalm, chemical warfare to destroy crops and ground cover, programs to drive the rural population, which was overwhelmingly supportive of the guerrillas, as they knew, to drive them into what amounted to concentration camps called strategic hamlets, to surround them with barbed wire, to protect them from the guerrillas who they were strongly supporting. It ended up with millions of people being driven out. I don't have to describe what happened to South Vietnam was virtually destroyed. The war expanded to the rest of the of Indochina, always with European support and with virtually no criticism. About 1966 or 67, there were few voices of criticism in educated circles on the grounds that it was not working very well. Same kind of grounds you hear today in Afghanistan, or you heard a couple of years ago about Iraq. It wasn't working too well, you know, maybe it was a mistake. In 1968, everything changed. In January 1968, there was an amazing uprising in South Vietnam. There's been nothing like it in history. The country was saturated with over 500,000 American troops, over 100,000 Thai, Korean, other mercenaries, a huge army, you know, 700,000 or 800,000 people. Every village penetrated, informants everywhere. All of a sudden, in January 1968, there was an uprising which no one knew about. Everyone had kept quiet, and it was all over the country, practically. You know, I went, broke into the American Embassy, you know. This is the Tet Offensive. I don't think there's ever been a case of such overwhelming commitment to a revolutionary cause. No one even talked about it. And it was a surprise everywhere. Well, that struck a chord with the American business community, the ones who are decisive in determining policy. It got them to recognize that this war isn't worth fighting any longer. We've basically won our objectives. It's a waste of money and time. and they pressured the government, a pretty strong power play, to reverse policy. And the government did follow orders, reverse policy, started withdrawing troops, entered in negotiations. The president announced that he's not going to run for a second term, and so on. The intellectuals responded almost reflexively. All of a sudden, everybody became a long-term opponent of the war without any trace that anyone can find. In fact, the record says the opposite. But that was the new party line. We're long-term opponents of the war, got to get out, was a mistake, shouldn't have gotten in, and so on. There are a number of leading figures in the Kennedy administration who wrote memoirs. Arthur Schlesinger, Roger Hilsman, Theodore Sorensen, others, they rewrote their memoirs, literally. The early memoirs, the ones written at the time, if you look at them, were fully supportive of the war, or often didn't even mention it because it was so uninteresting. The post-1968 story, which is the one that enters into history, is Kennedy was going to pull out of Vietnam. Everybody was opposed. Should never gotten in the first place. It's the bad Texan, Lyndon Johnson, who turned everything around. We, the intellectuals, were passionate opponents of the war. We couldn't make our case. That's the more or less official story today. If you go to 1975, when the war officially ended, it's quite interesting to look at what was being written then and what popular attitudes were then. At that time, among the public, about 70% of the population in polls said that the war was not a mistake. It was fundamentally wrong and immoral. That's 70% of the population. Not a phrase like that in the educated community. In fact, at the outside limits of criticism, say in the New York Times, the most dissident journalist, Anthony Lewis, wrote that the war began with blundering efforts to do good. Efforts to do good is tautological. The U.S. government was carrying it out, so it was efforts to do good. Blundering, yeah, it didn't work. So it began with blundering efforts to do good, but by 1969, that's after the Tet Offensive, it had become clear that the war was a mistake, and that we could not achieve our, by definition, noble objectives at a cost acceptable to ourselves. So it was really a mistake. That's the critical end of elite, educated, dissident opinion at a time when 70% of the population said, no, it's not a mistake, it's fundamentally wrong and immoral. Now, those are phrases that don't appear in educated discourse. Wrong and immoral, maybe wrong because it didn't work, but not immoral. And that's very typical. Take a look at current debate about, say, Iraq. At the outer limits of criticism within the educated mainstream, you have, for example, Barack Obama, who's very strongly praised and honored for his principled opposition to the war. What was his principled opposition? He said it's a strategic blunder. We're not going to be able to do it at a cost acceptable to ourselves. It's kind of like Nazi generals after Stalingrad. After Stalingrad, I'm sure there was criticism in the German general staff of Hitler's blunders. And why fight a two-front war when you should have knocked out England first and then gone ahead? So yeah, it was a strategic blunder. We don't call that principled criticism. I don't have records from the German general staff, but we do have records from the Soviet Union. If you read Pravda in the mid-1980s, that's the way they described the war in Afghanistan. It was a strategic blunder. Should never have gotten into it. Again, we don't call that principled criticism. We don't honor and respect them for that stand. But when it's done on our side, that's exactly what we do. Well, could go on and on about this, but
what is that title meant to describe?
Well, the title is actually borrowed from
a book by Walter Lippmann written back around 1921, in which he described what he called the manufacture of consent as a revolution in the practice of democracy. What it amounts to is a technique of control. And he said this was useful and necessary because the common interests, the general concerns of all people, elude the public. The public just isn't up to dealing with them. And they have to be the domain of what he called a specialized class. Notice that that's the opposite of the standard view about democracy. There's a version of this expressed by the highly respected moralist and theologian Reinhold Niebuhr, who was very influential on contemporary policymakers. His view was that rationality belongs to the cool observer, but because of the stupidity of the average man, he follows not reason but faith. And this naive faith requires necessary illusion and emotionally potent oversimplifications, which are provided by the myth maker to keep the ordinary person on course. It's not the case, as the naive might think, that indoctrination is inconsistent with democracy. Rather, as this whole line of thinkers observes, it's the essence of democracy. The point is that in a military state or a feudal state or what we would nowadays call a totalitarian state, it doesn't much matter what people think because you've got a bludgeon over their head and you can control what they do. But when the state loses the bludgeon, when you can't control people by force, and when the voice of the people can be heard, you have this problem. It may make people so curious and so arrogant that they don't have the humility to submit to a civil rule, and therefore you have to control what people think. And the standard way to do this is to resort to what in more honest days used to be called propaganda, manufacture of consent, creation of necessary illusions, various ways of either marginalizing the general public or reducing them to apathy in some fashion. Now, there are other media, too, whose basic social role is quite different. It's diversion.
There's the real mass media, the kinds that are aimed at, you know, the guys who Joe Sixpack, that kind. The purpose of those media is just to dull people's brains.
This is an oversimplification, but for the 80% or whatever they are, the main thing for them is to divert them, to get them to watch National Football League and to worry about, you know, mother with child with six heads or whatever you pick up in the, you know, in the thing that you pick up on the supermarket stands and so on. Or, you know, look at astrology or get involved in, you know, fundamentalist stuff or something. Just get them away, you know. Get them away from things that matter. And for that, it's important to reduce their capacity to think.
The sports section is handled in another special department. The sports reporter must be a specialist in his knowledge of sports. He gets his story right at the sporting event and often sends it into his paper play by play.
Take, say, sports. That's another crucial example of the indoctrination system, in my view. For one thing, because it offers people something to pay attention to that's of no importance, that keeps them from worrying about, you know, keeps them from worrying about things that matter to their lives that they might have some idea about doing something about. And in fact, it's striking to see the intelligence that's used by ordinary people in sports. I mean, you listen to radio stations where people call in. They have the most exotic information and understanding about, you know, all kind of arcane issues. And the press undoubtedly does a lot. I think if you look closely at these things, I think they do have functions. And that's why energy is devoted to supporting them and creating a basis for them, and advertisers are willing to pay for them and so on.
Whose consent is being manufactured?
We can, to start with, there are two different groups. We can get into more detail. But at the first level of approximation, there's two targets for propaganda. One is what's sometimes called the political class. there's maybe 20% of the population, which is relatively educated, more or less articulate, that plays some kind of role in decision-making. They're supposed to sort of participate in social life, either as managers or cultural managers, like, say, teachers and writers and so on. They're supposed to vote. They're supposed to play some role in the way economic and political and cultural life goes on. Now, their consent is crucial. It's one group that has to be deeply indoctrinated. Then there's maybe 80% of the population whose main function is to follow orders and not to think, you know, and not to pay attention to anything. And they're the ones who usually pay the cost.
Now, underlying these doctrines, which were very widely held, is a certain conception of democracy. It's a game for elites. It's not for the ignorant masses who have to be marginalized, diverted, and controlled, of course, for their own good. The same principles were upheld in the American colonies. The dictum of the founding fathers of American democracy that, I'm quoting, the people who own the country ought to govern it, quoting John Jay. The way things change is because lots of people are working all the time. And, you know, they're working in their communities, in their workplace, or wherever they happen to be, and they're building up the basis for popular movements which are going to make changes. That's the way everything has ever happened in history, you know, whether it was the end of slavery or whether it was the Democratic Revolutions or anything you want, you name it, that's the way it worked. You get a very false picture of this from the history books. In the history books, there's a couple of leaders, you know, George Washington or Martin Luther King or whatever. And I don't want to say that those people are unimportant. Like Martin Luther King was certainly important, but he was not the civil rights movement. Martin Luther King can appear in the history books because lots of people whose names you will never know and whose names are all forgotten and who may have been killed and so on were working down in the South.
When you have active activists and people concerned and people devoting themselves and dedicating themselves to social change or issues or whatever, then people like me can appear, and we can appear to be prominent, but that's only because somebody else is doing the work. My work, whether it's giving hundreds of talks a year or spending 20 hours a week writing letters or writing books, is not directed to intellectuals and politicians. It's directed to what are called ordinary people.
Yeah.
And what I expect from them is, in fact, exactly what they are, that they should try to understand the world and act in accordance with their decent impulses, and that they should try to improve the world. And many people are willing to do that, but they have to understand. And in fact, as far as I can see, in these things, I feel that I'm simply helping people develop courses of intellectual self-defense.
What did you mean by that?
What would such a course
well,
be?
I don't mean go to school, because you're not going to get it there. It means you have to develop an independent mind and work on it. Now, that's extremely hard to do alone. You know, the beauty of our system is it isolates everybody. Each person is sitting alone in front of the tube. You know? Now, it's very hard to have ideas or thoughts under those circumstances. You can't fight the world alone. Some people can, but it's pretty rare. The way to do it is through organization. So courses of intellectual self-defense will have to be in the context of political and other organization.
The truth is that things are not as simple as Professor Chomsky maintains.
Those who believe in democracy and freedom have a serious task ahead of them. What they should be doing, in my view, is dedicating their efforts to helping the despised common people to struggle for their rights and to realize the democratic goals that constantly surface throughout history. They should be serving not power and privilege, but rather their victims. Freedom and democracy are by now not merely values to be treasured, they are quite possibly the prerequisite to survival.
It's a conspiracy theory, pure and simple. It is not borne out by the facts. Mr. Chairman, I have to go to Amsterdam. If you'll excuse me, I'm leaving.
There is nothing more remote from what I'm discussing or what we have been discussing than a conspiracy theory. If I give an analysis of, say, the economic system, and I point out that General Motors tries to maximize profit and market share, that's not a conspiracy theory. That's an institutional analysis. It has nothing to do with conspiracies. And that's precisely the sense in which we're talking about the media. The phrase conspiracy theory is one of those that's constantly brought up, and I think its effect simply is to discourage institutional analysis.
I mean, it may be paradoxical, but the freer the society is, the more it's necessary to resort to devices like induced fear. What keeps the media functioning is not the audience.
They make money from their advertisers. And remember, we're talking about the elite media, so they're trying to sell a good product, a product which raises advertising rates. And ask your friends in the advertising industry, that means that they want to adjust their audience to the more elite and affluent audience that raises advertising rates. So what you have is institutions, corporations, big corporations, that are selling relatively privileged audiences to other businesses. Well, what point of view would you expect to come out of this? I mean, without any further assumptions, what you'd predict is that what comes out is a picture of the world, a perception of the world, that satisfies the needs and the interests and the perceptions of the sellers, the buyers, and the product. Now, there are many other factors that press in the same direction. If people try to enter the system who don't have that point of view, they're likely to be excluded somewhere along the way. After all, no institution is going to happily design a mechanism to self-destruct. It's not the way institutions function. So they all work to exclude or marginalize or eliminate dissenting voices or alternative perspectives and so on because they're dysfunctional. They're dysfunctional to the institution itself. But you can participate in it. You can add your own thoughts, you know, and you can learn something and so on. Well, that's the way people become human, you know. That's the way you become human participants in a social and political system.
The point is that you have to work. And that's why the propaganda system is so successful. Very few people are going to have the time or the energy or the commitment to carry out the constant battle that's required to get outside of, McNeely or Dan Rather or somebody like that. The easy thing to do, you know, you come home from work, you're tired, you've had a busy day, you know, going to spend the evening carrying out a research project. So you turn on the tube and say, it's probably right. Or you look at the headlines in the paper and then you watch the sports or something. That's basically the way the system of indoctrination works. Sure, the other stuff is there, but you're going to have to work to find it.
Modern industrial civilization has developed within a certain system of convenient myths. The driving force of modern industrial civilization has been individual material gain, which is accepted as legitimate, even praiseworthy, on the grounds that private vices yield public benefits in the classic formulation. Now, it's long been understood very well that a society that is based on this principle will destroy itself in time. It can only persist with whatever suffering and injustice it entails, as long as it's possible to pretend that the destructive forces that humans create are limited, that the world is an infinite resource, and that the world is an infinite garbage can. At this stage of history, either one of two things is possible. Either the general population will take control of its own destiny and will concern itself with community interests, guided by values of solidarity and sympathy and concern for others, or alternatively, there will be no destiny for anyone to control.
Now, the elite media are the sort of the agenda-setting media. That means the New York Times, the Washington Post, the major television channels, and so on. They set the general framework. Local media more or less adapt to their structure. They determine, they select, they shape, they control, they restrict in order to serve the interests of dominant elite groups in the society.
I'm Jeff Greenfield for Nightline in New York.
What about just in the selection of guests to analyze things? Why is Noam Chomsky never on Nightline?
I couldn't begin to tell you.
He's one of the leading intellectuals in the entire world.
I have no idea. I mean, I can make some guesses. He may be one of the leading intellectuals who can't talk on television. You know, that's a standard that's very important to us. If you got a 22-minute show and a guy takes 5 minutes to warm up, now, I don't know whether Chomsky does or not. He's out. One of the reasons why Nightline has the usual suspects is one of the things you have to do when you book a show is know that the person can make the point within the framework of television. And if people don't like that, they should understand it is about as sensible to book somebody who will take 8 minutes to give an answer as it is to book somebody who doesn't speak English. But in the normal given flow, that's another culture-bound thing. We got to have English-speaking people. We also need concision.
So Greenfield, or whatever his name is, hit the nail on the head. The U.S. media are alone in that it is, you must meet the condition of concision. You got to say things between two commercials or in 600 words. And that's a very important fact, because the beauty of concision, you know, saying a couple of sentences between two commercials, the beauty of that is that you can only repeat conventional thoughts.
I was reading Chomsky 20 years ago. I think his notion, didn't he co-author a new book called Engineering Consent or The Manufacturing of Consent? Mm-hmm. I mean, some of that stuff to me looks like it's from Neptune.
This is the first time the Neptune system has been seen clearly by human eyes. These pictures, taken only hours ago by Voyager 2, are its latest contribution.
You know, he's perfectly entitled to say that I'm seeing it through a prism, too. But my view of that, of his notions about the limits of debate in this country, is absolutely wacko.
Suppose I get up on Nightline, say, and I'm given whatever it is, 2 minutes, and I say Gaddafi's a terrorist, Khomeini's a murderer, you know, et cetera, et cetera. The Russians, you know, invaded Afghanistan, all this sort of stuff. I don't need any evidence. Everybody just nods. On the other hand, suppose you say something that just isn't regurgitating conventional pieties. Suppose you say something that's the least bit unexpected or controversial. Suppose you say,
I mean, the biggest international terror operations that are known are the ones that are run out of Washington.
Or suppose you say, what happened in the 1980s is the U.S. government was driven underground.
Suppose I say the United States is invading South Vietnam, as it was.
The best political leaders are the ones who are lazy and corrupt.
If the Nuremberg laws were applied, then every post-war American president would have been hanged.
The Bible is probably the most genocidal book in our total canon.
Education is a system of imposed ignorance.
There's no more morality in world affairs fundamentally than there was in the time of Genghis Khan. They're just different, you know, they're just different factors to be concerned with.
Noam Chomsky, thank you.
Well, you know, people will quite reasonably expect to know what you mean. Why did you say that? I never heard that before. If you said that, you better have a reason, you know, you better have some evidence. In fact, you better have a lot of evidence, because that's a pretty startling comment. You can't give evidence if you're stuck with concision. You know, that's the genius of this structural constraint. And in my view, if people like, say, Nightline and McNeil Lehrer and so on were smarter, if they were better propagandists, they would let dissidents on. Let them on more, in fact. The reason is that they would sound like they're from Neptune.
Then comes our special conversation on the Middle East crisis. Tonight's is with the activist, writer, and professor Noam Chomsky.
Again, there has been an offer on the table, which we rejected, an Iraqi offer last April,
to eliminate
their chemical and other unconventional arsenals if Israel were to simultaneously do the same.
Have to
we
end
rejected it
there. It,
but I think that should be pursued as well.
Sorry to interrupt you. I have to end it there. That's the end of our time. Professor Chomsky, thank you very much for joining us.
AT&T has supported the McNeil Lehrer News Hour since 1983, because quality information and quality communications is our idea of a good connection. AT&T, the right choice.
I mean, given the natural advantages that the United States has in terms of resources and lack of enemies and so on, the United States should have a level of health and welfare and so on that's, you know, order of magnitude beyond anybody else in the world. We don't. The United States is last among 20 industrialized societies in infant mortality. That's a scandal of American capitalism. And it ends up being a very free society, which does a lot of rotten things in the world. Okay? There's no contradiction there. I mean, you know, Greece was a free society by the standards of Athens, you know. It's also a vicious society from the point of view of its imperial behavior. There's virtually no correlation between maybe none, between the internal freedom of a society and its external behavior.
So I work with student press, and I know like reporters and stuff.
The elites don't control the student press, but I'll tell you something. You try in the student press to do anything that breaks out of conventions, and you're going to have the whole business community around here down on your neck, and the university is going to get threatened, and you know. I mean, maybe nobody will pay any attention to you, that's possible. But if you get to the point where they don't stop paying attention to you, the pressures will start coming. Because there are people with power. There are people who own the country, and they're not going to let the country get out of control.
As long as some specialized class is in a position of authority, it is going to set policy in the special interests that it serves. But the conditions of survival, let alone justice, require rational social planning in the interests of the community as a whole, and by now that means the global community. The question is whether privileged elites should dominate mass communication and should use this power as they tell us they must, namely to impose necessary illusions, to manipulate and deceive the stupid majority and remove them from the public arena. The question, in brief, is whether democracy and freedom are values to be preserved or threats to be avoided. In this possibly terminal phase of human existence, democracy and freedom are more than values to be treasured. They may well be essential to survival. Thank you.
He's up there thinking for himself, and he's deciphering this tremendously overweighted body of information, which he puts into an order and gives you the feeling that you can do the same thing, that the whole thing is decipherable. And he also gives you the sense that there is a source, there's a center to the to a dissenting population, although we feel that there's no center. And I think that is what reactivated in me a desire to get back, get reacquainted with the political scene after 30 years of alienation from it.
You do hundreds of interviews and lectures, and you're dealing with massacres in East Timor and invasions of Panama, etc. Pretty horrific stuff, death squads. What keeps you going? I mean, don't you get burned out on this material?
Well, you know, it's mainly a matter of whether you can look yourself in the mirror, I think.
I think that we can see quite clearly some very, very serious defects and flaws in our society, our level of culture, our institutions, which are going to have to be corrected by operating outside of the framework that is commonly accepted. I think we're going to have to find new ways of political action.
In the street, singing songs and a carry inside. Mostly said for our side. It's time we stop. Hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going on.
See, I think the point that I'm trying to make, and I think ought to be made, is that the real at least to me, I say this elsewhere in the book, the what seems to me a very, in a sense, terrifying aspect of our society and other societies is the equanimity and the detachment with which sane, reasonable, sensible people mm-hmm. can observe such events. I think that's more terrifying than the occasional Hitler or LeMay or other that crops up. These people would not be able to operate were it not for this apathy and equanimity. And therefore, I think that it's, in some sense, the sane and reasonable and tolerant people who share a very serious burden of guilt that they very easily throw on the shoulders of others who seem more extreme and more violent.
People don't want a war unless you have to have one, and they would have known that you don't have to have one. Well, the media kept people from knowing that, and that means we went to war very much in the manner of a totalitarian state, thanks to the media subservience. That's the big story.
Remember, I'm not talking about a small radio station in Laramie. I'm talking about the national agenda-setting media. If you're on a radio news show in Laramie, chances are very strong that you
pick up what was in the Times that morning and you decide that's the news. In fact, if you follow the AP wires, you find that in the afternoon, they send across tomorrow's front page of the New York Times. That's so that everybody knows what the news is. And the perceptions and the perspectives and so on are sort of transmitted down, and not to the precise detail, but the general picture is pretty much transmitted elsewhere.
I've been asked to talk about modern-day American imperialism. That's a rather challenging task. In fact, talking about American imperialism is a little bit like talking about triangular triangles. The United States is the one country that exists, as far as I know, and ever has, that was founded as an empire explicitly. According to the Founding Fathers, when the country was founded, it was a nascent empire. That's George Washington. Modern-day American imperialism is just a later phase of a process that has continued from the first moment without a break, going in a very steady line. So we're looking at one phase in a process that was initiated when the country was founded and has never changed. The model for the Founding Fathers, borrowed from Britain at that time, was the Roman Empire. And they wanted to emulate it. I'll talk about that a little. Even before the Revolution, these notions were very much alive. Benjamin Franklin, 25 years before the Revolution, complained to the British that they were imposing limits on the expansion of the colonies. And he objected to this. He, borrowing from Machiavelli, he admonished the British, I'm quoting him, that a prince that acquires new territories and removes the natives to give his people room will be remembered as the father of the nation. And George Washington agreed. He wanted to be the father of the nation. His view was that the gradual extension of our settlement will as certainly cause the savage as the wolf to retire, both being beasts of prey, though they differ in shape. I'll skip some contemporary analogs that you can think of. Thomas Jefferson, the most forthcoming of the Founding Fathers, said, "We shall drive them, the savages, we shall drive them with the beasts of the forests into the stony mountains, and the country will ultimately be free of blot or mixture," meaning red or black. Wasn't quite achieved, but that was the goal. Furthermore, Jefferson went on, "Our new nation will be the nest from which all America, North and South, is to be peopled," displacing not only the red men here, but the Spanish-speaking population to the South and anyone else who happened to be around. There was a deterrent to those glorious aims, mainly Britain. And Britain was the most powerful military force in the world at the time, and it did prevent the steps that the Founding Fathers attempted to take. In particular, it blocked the invasion of Canada. The first attempted invasion of Canada was before the Revolution, and there were several others later, but it was always blocked by British force, which is why Canada exists. The United States did not actually recognize Canada's existence until after the First World War. Another goal that was blocked by British force was Cuba. The Founding Fathers regarded the taking over of Cuba as essential to the survival of the nascent empire. But the British fleet was in the way, and they were too powerful, just like the Russians blocked John F. Kennedy's invasions. They understood that it would, sooner or later, would come. The great grand strategist, John Quincy Adams, the sort of intellectual father of Manifest Destiny, he pointed out in the 1820s that we just have to wait. They said Cuba will sooner or later fall into our hands by the laws of political gravitation, just as an apple falls from the tree. What he meant is that over time, the United States would become more powerful, that Britain would become weaker, and the deterrent would be overcome, which in fact finally happened. And we should not ignore these early events. They are very much related to current history. That's made very clear by scholarship on current affairs. So the major scholarly work on the Bush Doctrine, George W. Bush Doctrine, the preemptive war doctrine, major work is by John Lewis Gaddis, who's the most respected historian of the Cold War period. It's on the roots of the Bush Doctrine. And he traces it right back to John Quincy Adams, who is his hero, the great grand strategist, in particular to Andrew Jackson's invasion of Florida, which conquered Florida from the Spanish. And that was strongly approved by then Secretary of State Adams in a famous state paper in which he advocated the principle of preemptive war on the basis of the thesis that expansion is the path to security. So if we want to be secure, after all, we want to defend ourselves, we have to expand. At that time, expand into Florida. We were being threatened by what were called runaway slaves and lawless Indians who were in the way. They were threatening us by their existence, by barring our expansion. And as Gaddis points out, there's a straight line from that to George Bush, and now expansion is the path to security. It means we take over the world, we take over space, take over the galaxy. There's no limit to how much you have to expand to guarantee security. And that's been the principle from the beginning. Gaddis is a good historian, and he cites the right sources on the so-called Seminole War, Jackson's conquest of Florida, but he doesn't bother telling us what the sources say, and it's worth looking at what they say. They describe it as a war of murder and plunder and extermination, driving out the indigenous population. There were pretexts made, but they were so flimsy that nobody paid much attention to them. It was also the first executive war in violation of the Constitution, setting a precedent which has been followed ever since. There was no congressional authorization. It's all a lie. Adams lied through his teeth to Congress. I mean, it's all very familiar. So Gaddis is correct. It is the model for the Bush Doctrine. He approves of both of them, but that's a moral judgment. But his analysis is correct. Yes, what's happening now traces right back to the wars of extermination and plunder and murder and lying and deceit and so on, executive wars of that John Quincy Adams was the great spokesman for. Adams, incidentally, later in his life, regretted this. He, after his own contributions were well in the past, he condemned the Mexican War as an executive war and terrible precedent. It wasn't a precedent. He'd established the precedent. And he also expressed remorse over what he called that hapless race of Native Americans, which we are exterminating with such merciless and perfidious cruelty. They knew what they were doing. Contemporary history likes to prettify it, but if you read the descriptions and the observations by the people who were involved, they knew exactly what they were doing. He expressed regret for it, but of course his own role was long past. It's commonly argued that American imperialism began in 1898. That's when, in 1898, the U.S. did finally succeed in conquering Cuba, what's called in the history books liberating Cuba, namely intervening in order to prevent Cuba from liberating itself from Spain and turning it into a virtual colony as it remained till 1959, setting off hysteria in the United States, which hasn't ended yet. Also conquering, taking over Hawaii, which was stolen by force and guile from its population, Puerto Rico, another colony, soon moving to the Philippines and liberating the Philippines, also liberating a couple of 100,000 souls to heaven in the process, and again, the reverberations of that extend right to the present, with ample state terror and the one corner of Asia that hasn't undergone a high development, something we're not supposed to notice. But the belief that all that the imperial thrust started in 1898 is an example of what historians of empire call the salt water fallacy, the belief that you have an empire if you cross salt water. In fact, if the Mississippi River were as wide as the Irish Sea, the imperial thrust would have started much earlier. But that's an irrelevance. I mean, expanding over settled territory is no different from expanding over the waters. So what happened in 1898 was just an extension of the process that began when the nascent empire, as it saw itself, was formed in its first moments. The extension to beyond was, again, a lot of this starts right in New England with New England merchants who wanted to, very eager to take over the Pacific trade, the fabulous markets of China, which were always in their minds, which meant conquering the Northwest so you can control the ports and so on, meant kicking the British out and others out and so on. But went on from right here. The goal, as William Seward, who was Secretary of State in the 1860s, pointed out that the central figure in American imperialism, that we have to gain command of the empire of the seas. We've conquered the continent. We're going to settle, take it over. Monroe Doctrine was a declaration that we'll take it over, everybody else keep out. And the process of doing so continued through the 19th century and beyond until today. But now we have to have command of the seas. And that meant when the time was ripe, 30 years later, when the apple started to fall from the tree, given relative power, proceeding overseas to the overseas empire. But it's basically no different than the earlier steps. The leading philosophical imperialist, Brooks Adams, he pointed out that this is 1895, we're just on the verge of moving overseas extensively, that all Asia must be reduced to our economic system. The Pacific must be turned into an inland sea, just like the Caribbean had been. And there's no reason, he said, why the United States should not become a greater seat of wealth and power than ever was England, Rome, or Constantinople. Well, again, there was a deterrent. The European powers wanted a piece of the action in East Asia, and Japan by then was becoming a formidable force. So it was necessary to explore more complex modes of gaining command of turning the Pacific into an inland sea and going on. And that was lucidly explained by Woodrow Wilson, who is one of the most brutal and vicious interventionists in American history. The probable permanent destruction of Haiti is one of his many accomplishments. Those of you who study international relations theory or read about it know that there's a notion of Wilsonian idealism. The fact that that notion can exist is a very interesting commentary on our intellectual culture and scholarly culture. If you look at his actual actions, fine words are easy enough. But these are some of his fine words, which he was smart enough not to put into print. He just wrote them for himself. He said, "Since trade ignores national boundaries and the manufacturer insists on having the world as a market, the flag of his nation must follow him, and the doors of the nations which are closed against him must be battered down, even if the sovereignty of unwilling nations be outraged in the process. No useful corner of the world may be overlooked or left unset, left unused." That's 1907. There's a current version of that, a crude version by Thomas Friedman, who says that McDonald's cannot flourish without McDonnell Douglas, meaning the U.S. Air Force. Well, that's a crude version of Wilson's point. They got to batter down the doors by force and threat, and no corner of the world must be left unused, no useful corner. There was a watershed in this process at the time of the Second World War. At the time of the Second World War, the U.S. already had by far the largest economy in the world and had for a long time. But it wasn't a major player in world affairs. Britain was the leading player, France second, the United States lagging. It controlled the hemisphere, you know, had made forays into the Pacific, but it was not the leading player. Last November, there was a declaration, an agreement by George Bush and what's called the Iraqi government, which is, a little enclave inside the green zone, never gets outside it, which we call the Iraqi government, the client government that follows our orders. So an agreement was made between them, which is interesting. It permits the U.S. to maintain effectively permanent military bases and operations inside Iraq. It has all kind of pretexts, but that's what it amounts to. And rather brazenly, to my surprise, it says that the Iraqi economy must be open to foreign investment, privileging U.S. investors. It's unusual to see such a brazen statement of crass imperialism. You know, the Iraqi economy means oil. Nobody cares about the asparagus they grow. So it must be open to foreign investment, unlike other countries which have controlled their own resources. And it must privilege U.S. investors. I mean, you know, that's more extreme than the most extreme war critic ever said. And Bush underscored it in one of his many hundreds of signing statements a couple of months later in January, in which he said that he would he signed some legislation, but he said, I'm not going to live up to it. In fact, I won't live up to any legislation that interferes with the U.S. goal of maintaining sort of permanent capacity for military operations there and controls the energy resources. Well, that's totally different from Vietnam. U.S. didn't care. Once the country was destroyed and Laos was destroyed and Cambodia was destroyed, the U.S. didn't care very much what happened, happy to pull out. This is just a completely different situation, both domestically and in terms of the geopolitics of it.
My question is, most people, we can sit here and have a discussion on the problems that we've had in the past in Panama or Guatemala and Cuba, and we can also talk about how we supported the Shah and we basically affected the Iranian Revolution. But the fact is that most people in America don't even know that at one point we supported Saddam Hussein. So knowing this fact, how can we help educate the rest of the American public on all of these issues when it seems that, you know, the media won't do it and it's all of this information that you say is easy to find is maybe not so easy for the average person? So.
Yeah. First of all, you're right about supporting Saddam Hussein, but very few people know the extent of the support. I mean, in 1982, Saddam Hussein was hanged a couple of months ago, or a year ago, whatever it was. And if you look, he was hanged for crimes that he committed in 1982. He was alleged to have ordered the killing of 150 or so people, which by his standards was like, you know, toothpick on a mountain. But that's what he was judged for. But it was kind of interesting to see the commentary on it. Something else happened in 1982. In 1982, the Reagan administration removed Iraq from the list of states supporting terror, which is a name for the list of states we want to go after. It has nothing to do with supporting terror. So they removed it from the list in order that the U.S. could start providing aid and support to their friend Saddam Hussein. Donald Rumsfeld went shortly afterwards to, you know, sign the friendly agreement. And through the 1980s, the U.S. was one of a number of states who gave support to Saddam Hussein. A lot of it was agricultural support, which he desperately needed, and it was a big boon to U.S. agribusiness, but also weapons support, you know, means to develop weapons of mass destruction and so on. This went on right through Saddam Hussein's worst atrocities, you know, the Halabja massacres, the Anfal massacres, you know, everything. Use of chemical weapons, it went all the way through. Not a, I mean, there was some protest. Congress protested now and then, but Reagan vetoed any effort to do anything about it. George Bush, number one, came along. He was a particular admirer of Saddam. In 1989, at the very time of the invasion of Panama, just as the invasion of Panama was going on, Bush overrode the Treasury Department and authorized new aid to his friend Saddam Hussein. The press cooperated by not reporting it. Also in 1989, Bush invited Iraqi nuclear engineers to the United States to get advanced training in weapons production. Nuclear weapons production. Okay, that's also 1989. Early 1990, Bush sent a high-level senatorial delegation to Iraq, led by Bob Dole, Republican Senate Majority Leader, who was then presidential candidate a couple of years later. And the goal, the purpose of the delegation was to send George Bush's good wishes to his friend Saddam to ensure him that he could disregard the kind of protests he hears now and then from the American press. We have this free press thing here, and we can't shut all these guys up. And told him that they would take off from the Voice of America anybody who was criticizing him. That was generally kind of a love session. That was April 1990. Okay, a couple of months later, Saddam Hussein disobeyed orders, or maybe misunderstood orders, which is possible, and invaded Kuwait. Okay, shifted instantly from favored friend and ally to reincarnation of Hitler. You know, you don't disobey orders. You know, like I said, any mafia don understands. That's the support. And incidentally, shortly after that, Washington returned to support for Saddam Hussein. After the war was a murderous, destructive war, you know, way beyond anything that was needed to get Saddam out of Kuwait. But right after the war, by March 1991, the U.S. had total control, military control of the region, control of the air, everything. And there was a large Shiite uprising in the south, which probably would have overthrown Saddam. But the U.S. authorized Saddam to crush it. They authorized him to use aircraft, military helicopters, and so on to crush the uprising, killing probably tens of thousands of Shiites in the south. Schwarzkopf, who was a general, said later that he was fooled by Saddam. He didn't realize that when he authorized Saddam to use military aircraft, he'd actually use them. So kind of, you know, we were tricked. But it was explained pretty frankly by the New York Times. The chief diplomatic correspondent, Thomas Friedman — a chief diplomatic correspondent means State Department spokesperson in the New York Times, just relays State Department propaganda — he wrote a clear column. He said the best of all possible worlds. He supported the decision to allow Saddam to crush the uprising. He said the best of all worlds for the United States would be an iron-fisted military junta ruling Iraq just the way Saddam did, but with a different name, because he's now kind of embarrassment. And so we have to settle for second best, you know, Saddam himself. The Middle East correspondent for the New York Times, who's still there, top Middle East correspondent, Alan Cowell, he said, well, you know, it's kind of unpleasant watching all these people get massacred. He said, but there's a consensus among the United States and its allies, namely Britain and Saudi Arabia, that the best hope for stability in Iraq is Saddam Hussein, not the people who are trying to overthrow him. Okay, so therefore we have to let Saddam crush the uprising that might have overthrown him. Stability is a technical term. It means following U.S. orders. Okay, so that's stability, and Saddam's more hopeful for stability than Iraqis. In fact, what it upset is, you know, the worst possible outcome is that Iraqis might rule Iraq. We're not going to allow that. Independent nationalism is not to be accepted. That's why Muqtada al-Sadr is a renegade and so on. And in fact, through the 90s, it's the same story. If you look at the main effect of the sanctions, Clinton's sanctions, I mean, they were murderous and destructive, but they strengthened Saddam Hussein, they undermined opposition to him, they compelled the population to rely on him for survival, which is probably the reason he wasn't overthrown. You know, otherwise, he probably would have had the same fate as Ceausescu and Suharto and Mobutu and a whole bunch of gangsters not very different from him, who the U.S. supported until the end. But in fact, that's exactly what was said by Dennis Halliday and Hans von Sponeck, the two directors of the Oil for Food program, who, as I said, knew more about Iraq than certainly any Westerner. So maybe so, you know, it's, but it's crucial that Iraqis not rule Iraq. Yes, there was support. Now, how do we get any of this stuff to the American people? Well, you know, how do you get anything else to the population? Was it you who quoted Margaret Mead at the beginning? Yeah, that's the way you do it. Everything happens exactly the way you said. Exactly, in, you know, take the civil rights movement, the women's movement, the anti-Vietnam anti-war movement. Pick anything you like. The environmental movement starts with small groups of people doing things, and gradually it grows. And finally, it gets to the point where, as in the case of the anti-Vietnam war movement, where the government was afraid to send troops because they'd need them for civil disorder control. All that happened within about 2 years. You know? And it just changed the world. I mean, a striking example is the women's movement. You know, it's not that, I mean, there were feminists before, but until the 1960s, you know, there was nothing much was happening. And within a couple of years, it changed the country and the world dramatically. It's probably the major impact of the 60s on the world. And it happened just by consciousness-raising groups, bigger groups, activism wherever it was necessary, and so on. Civil rights movement was the same. A couple of black kids sat at a lunch counter, and freedom bus riders started rioting, and pretty soon you had a huge mass movement, which didn't solve the problems, obviously, but solved a lot of them, made it a lot better. This is one of the most important things happening in the world, I think. It's not Latin America, unfortunately, it's South America. Central America was so devastated by Reaganite terror, it may never recover. So they're not part of this much. I mean, a little, but not much. But South America is undergoing a really dramatic change. I mean, it's the first time since the Spanish invasions that the countries of South America are beginning to face two fundamental problems which have turned them into like a horror story. You know, some of the worst poverty and misery in the world in a region with enormous resources and a lot of potential. You know, it's not a desert somewhere. The two problems are both problems of sort of disintegration. One of them internal to each society, another among all the societies. The Latin American societies typically have been run by a very small, wealthy, largely white elite, race-class correlations pretty close, with a mass of suffering and misery. That's been an internal problem. So if you compare it with East Asia, it's striking. I mean, Latin America has many advantages over East Asia. It should be way ahead in development. But in Latin America, capital is exported by the tiny rich elite. The imports are luxury goods so they can, live it up. Their second homes are in the Riviera or someplace like that. The children go to school overseas. But they have almost nothing to do with their own population. No responsibility, they pay taxes, nothing. The disintegration among the countries is that they are all separated from one another. Like, there's very little interaction among them during the colonial period and even the period of independence. You can see that in the transportation systems and almost everything. Well, those things are changing. Strikingly, I think the most dramatic case is Bolivia, which is really impressive what happened. And you're right, it's under a lot of threat now. The white elite that's always run the place is infuriated that they had a democratic election for the first time. And the U.S. is just as infuriated. Democratic elections are a real danger. But they had a remarkable democratic election in which the large majority of the population, mostly indigenous, entered the political arena, elected someone from their own ranks on crucial issues, did you say some phrase that you shouldn't have said, but on real issues, control of resources, issues of cultural rights, of justice, and so on, and they won. And they were not just pushing a button on election day. These were continuing struggles. control over water, all sorts of things, sometimes very bitter struggles. And they had developed mass popular organizations, and they had a democratic election of a kind that is unimaginable in the United States or in the West altogether. And yes, now there's a serious effort to overturn it. This is strong secessionist movement. We don't have documents, but I'm sure it's backed by the United States to try to support the rich, mostly white minority to pull out, and that happens to be where most of the natural resources are. And the majority wants to hold the country together and carry forward the significant changes that are taking place. And there's also, and that's happening in the other countries too that you mentioned, including Brazil, the most important. And there's a lot of integration going on. In fact, the whole region, almost the entire region, is sort of moving to the left. Well, the U.S. had means of stopping this, two means, violence and economic strangulation. And both means have been severely weakened. Korea throwing out the Manta Air Base is a symbol of the weakening of the weapon of violence. Traditionally, the U.S., when anything like this happened, the U.S. just carried out a military coup, or instigated a military coup, installed a bunch of gangsters, and that was the end of it. But they can't do that now. The last time the U.S. tried a military coup was in Venezuela in 2002, where they did manage to, the U.S.-backed military coup did manage to overthrow the government, but it was overturned within a couple of days. And there was huge protest all over Latin America, and the U.S. had to back off, and they haven't been able to do it since. The economic strangulation is also weakened. The economic strangulation in recent years has been, the instrument of it has been the IMF, International Monetary Fund, which is basically a branch of the U.S. Treasury. So the idea is, get the countries deeply indebted, give impossible debts that they can never pay. The debts are not from the population, they're from the elites. The population didn't borrow the money and didn't gain anything from it. But the international rules are they're the ones who have to pay it. Okay, well, that's being overcome. Country after country is, as the Argentine president put it, ridding ourselves of the IMF, restructuring the debts, repaying the debts. Argentina did it with the help of Venezuela. Brazil did it in its own way. And the IMF is actually in trouble. It's not getting enough funding by debt repayment. And in general, the method of economic strangulation is declining, partly because of the integration. The countries are working together. The standard U.S. line now, the press, scholarship, and so on, is that there are two kinds. They have to admit that Latin America is moving left, but there's a good left and a bad left. The good left is Lula in Brazil. The bad left is, of course, Chavez and Morales and maybe Correa. But in order to maintain that party line, you have to be quick on your feet. For example, you have to overlook the fact that one of the strongest supporters of Chavez is Lula. That doesn't fit the party line, so it doesn't get reported. After Lula in Brazil, after he was reelected, his first act practically was to fly to Caracas to support Chavez in his electoral campaign and to dedicate a joint Venezuelan-Brazilian project. There's now more projects developing. Shortly after that, there was a very important meeting of the Latin American presidents in Cochabamba in Bolivia, very important place. That's where the Bolivian Revolution took off. That's where peasants began protesting the World Bank U.S. programs to privatize water, which means water's out of people can't drink because they can't pay the costs. So they succeeded in throwing out the Bechtel Corporation and blocking the efforts. It wasn't easy. A lot of people got killed. That's Cochabamba. It's a real symbol. So that's where the Latin American presidents met. It was December 2006. And they made interesting plans, joint plans, for a European Union-type integration, and actually taking steps towards it. And the U.S. just doesn't have much that it can do about it. It's lost its main weapons. Now, there are plenty of internal problems to overcome, so it's not going to be an easy path. But this is the first time they're being seriously faced, and with the participation of substantial mass popular movements. That's the basis for democracy. It's one of the reasons why we don't have a functioning democracy. We don't have mass popular movements. So therefore, popular opinion can be mostly disregarded as it is. But they're overcoming that. It's a real model to look for. The U.S. is by no means giving up. You may have read in the paper a couple of days ago that a training of military officers is being shifted from the State Department to the Pentagon. That's been going on for some time now, in fact, but they finally reported it. That's quite significant. Training within the State Department is at least theoretically under congressional supervision, meaning that there are human rights conditionalities and so on. And once it moves into the Pentagon, it's just a black hole. They can do anything they want. Nobody ever looks. Training and torture, whatever you do. It's a weak control, but it's something. Furthermore, training of Latin American officers is shot way up. The U.S. is trying very hard to recreate a Latin American officer corps that will be able to follow its orders. I think it's now higher than it's ever been through the Cold War years. And the purposes are explicit. The training is designed to combat what's called radical populism. Well, in the Latin American context, radical populism means human rights activists, union leaders, priests organizing peasants, anybody who gets in the way. And that's the explicit goal of the training of officers. And training of officers just doesn't mean just teaching them. It means providing them with technology and weapons and connections and so on. So the U.S. is certainly trying to recreate the weapon of violence and also the economic weapons, but it's not as easy as it was. For one thing, there's much more protest here, which is a good thing. For another thing, there's the whole world has become more diverse. So exporters in Latin America can now turn to China for markets, and China's investing. There are also South-South relations developing. So Brazil, South Africa, and India now have relations. All of this, these moves are very positive, I think, and could lead to the basis for some kind of authentic independence and also for overcoming the enormous internal problems. So that's these are all very hopeful signs, I think. It's probably true that North Korea isn't living up to all its obligations in its declaration, but it's also true that the United States is not living up to its obligations. In fact, in the rare reporting on this that you can occasionally find, the last report was that the original agreement was that Iraq would dismantle its nuclear facilities and produce a declaration of its nuclear activities, and the United States would join with the other six powers in providing Iraq with fuel, other aid, and the U.S. would enter into normal diplomatic relations and remove them from the isolation of North Korea by taking them off the list of states that support terror and so on. Well, the U.S. has done none of that. You know. Furthermore, there's a history of this. The same negotiations, same agreement, pretty much, was reached in September 2005. North Korea agreed to dismantle, to end all nuclear weapons-related operations, all nuclear operations, end them all verifiably, and the United States, in return, would enter into diplomatic relations, remove the threats to Korea, and provide it with a light water reactor and a couple of other things, and end all threats. Okay, that would end the crisis. A couple of days later, the United States carried out what the five NATO generals now call an act of war against North Korea. They closed down North Korean financial operations, which happened to be in a small bank in Macau. It was probably a trial run for what they're now doing against Iran to see how it would work. Well, you know, that's a very serious attack on a country, to isolate it from the international financial system, no exports, no imports, and so on and so forth. And it was almost certainly done in order to undercut the negotiations that had just been reached. And in fact, North Korea reacted as you'd expect, carried out a nuclear test, you know, went on to develop missiles and so on. And that's been the history all the way back. You know, North Korea may have the worst government in the world, but they've been following a pretty pragmatic course on this. When the U.S. gets more aggressive, they get more aggressive. When the U.S. gets more conciliatory, they get more conciliatory. And it's been running steadily all the way through. So that's the other part of the story. And there's another part of the story that's even more significant. I don't know if North Korea has been providing anything to Syria or not, but there would have been an easy way to stop this, a very easy way. In 1993, North Korea and Israel were on the verge of an agreement by which Israel would recognize North Korea and North Korea would terminate all weapons-related activities in the Middle East. Now, that would be very important for Israel's security, but the Clinton administration said no. They wouldn't let them do it. And when the Godfather speaks, you got to listen. So that agreement was never reached. And if that agreement had been reached, we would not be having any discussion about whether North Korea is doing anything in Syria or not. Well, that part of the story is knocked out. Now, it's not that it's secret. You know, if you do some research or you read the arms control literature and so on, yeah, you can find it. Actually, I've written about it too and have others. But it's certainly not the headline where it ought to be. It's not something that people know. Another small point was made by Andrew Cordesman, who's one of the leading Middle East security specialists in the United States, who suggested that maybe this whole flap is just a warning to Iran, saying, you know, we got our eyes on you. And if you do anything, or even if you don't do anything, we'll pretend that you did and you're in trouble. You know. So yes, there's a lot to the story. But exactly what's going on, we don't know, and probably won't know until declassified documents come out someday, if they ever do. However, during the war, U.S. planners understood that the war was going to end with the U.S., the world dominant power. However, it turned out other competitors were going to destroy themselves and each other, and the U.S. would be left alone at comparable security. In fact, the U.S. gained enormously from the war. Industrial production virtually quadrupled. The war ended the Depression. The New Deal measures hadn't done so. The U.S. ended, at the end of the war, the U.S. had literally half the world's wealth, and competitors were virtually either damaged or destroyed, incomparable security. Controlled the Western Hemisphere, controlled both oceans, controlled the opposite side of both oceans. There's just nothing remotely like it in history. And during the war, planners understood that something like that was going to turn out. It was obvious from the nature of the war. From 1939 to 1945, there were high-level meetings, regular meetings, of the State Department planners and the Council on Foreign Relations, the sort of main external non-governmental input into foreign policy. And they laid careful plans for the world that they expected to emerge. It was a world, they said, in which the United States will hold unquestioned power and will ensure the limitation of any exercise of sovereignty by states that might interfere with U.S. global designs. Incidentally, I'm not quoting neocons. You know, I'm quoting the Roosevelt administration, the peak of American liberalism. They called for what they called an integrated policy to achieve military and economic supremacy for the United States and bar any exercise of sovereignty by anyone who would interfere with it. And they would do this in a region that they called the Grand Area. Well, in the early part of the war, 1939 to 1943, the Grand Area was defined as the Western Hemisphere routinely, the former British Empire, which the U.S. would take over, and the Far East. That would be the Grand Area. They assumed at the time that there would be a German-led world, the rest. So it would be a non-German world, that's us, and a German world. As the Russians gradually ground down the Nazi armies after 1942, it became pretty clear that there wouldn't be a German world. So the Grand Area was expanded to be as much of the world as could be controlled. Limitless. That's simply pursuing the old position that expansion is the path to security for the nascent empire of 1776. These policies were laid down during the war, but then they were implemented right after the war. In fact, now that we have available in the declassified record the planning documents of the late 1940s, it turns out they're not very surprisingly very similar to the wartime planning. One of the leading figures was George Kennan, who was head of the State Department policy planning staff. He wrote one of his many important papers in 1948, PPS 23, if you want to look it up, noted that the United States has half the world's wealth, but only 6% of its population, and our primary goal in foreign policy must be, as he put it, to maintain this disparity. And in order to do so, we must put aside all vague and idealistic slogans about democracy and human rights. Those are for public propaganda and colleges and so on. But we must put those aside and keep to pure power concepts. There's going to be no other way to maintain the disparity. And then in the same paper and elsewhere, he and his staff went through the world, assigned to each part of the world what would be what they called its function within this global system that in which the U.S. would have unchallenged power, unquestioned power. So Latin America and the Middle East obviously would provide the energy resources that we would control, gradually pushing out Britain, throwing out France immediately and pushing out Britain slowly over the years and turning it into essentially a junior partner, as the British Foreign Office ruefully described their role at that time. Latin America we simply control. It's our little region over here, which has never bothered anyone, as Secretary of War Stimson said, while the U.S. was violating the principles it was establishing by setting up a regional organization in violation of the U.N. Charter and so on. So Latin America we keep, Middle East we control. Southeast Asia would be, its function was to provide resources and raw materials to the former colonial powers. Meanwhile, we would purchase them too. That would send dollars there, which the colonial powers would take, not the population. And they could use those to Britain, France, Netherlands, could use the dollars to purchase U.S. manufacturers. It's called a triangular trading arrangement, which would allow the U.S. had the only really functioning industrial system in the world, had a huge excess of manufacturing products, and there was what was called a dollar gap. The countries we wanted to sell it to didn't have dollars. That's Europe, basically. So we had to provide them with dollars, and the role of function of Southeast Asia was to play a role in that, hence the support for French colonialism and recapturing its Indochinese colony and so on. There was various variations, but that's the basic story. And so Kennan went through the world and assigned them its function, each part. When he got to Africa, he decided that the United States really didn't have much interest in Africa at that time, and therefore we should hand it over to the Europeans to exploit, it's his word, to exploit for their reconstruction. He said it would also give them a kind of a psychological lift after the damage of the war and while we were taking over all of their domains. You could imagine a different relationship between Europe and Africa in the light of history, but that couldn't even be considered. I mean, it was like too outlandish to discuss and still is. So Africa was to be exploited by Europe for its reconstruction, with consequences we know. The U.S. has since gotten into the act. Well, that was Kennan. He was removed from office soon after because he was considered too soft-hearted, not up to dealing with this harsh world, and he was replaced with real tough guys, Dean Acheson, Paul Nitze, and others, and there's no time to go through it, but if you ever want an education on hysterical jingoist fanaticism, you really should read their documents. If you've studied these issues, you've heard of at least NSC 68, which is discussed by everyone, but its rhetoric is omitted. And you have to look at its rhetoric to see what's going on in these crazed heads of the great thinkers. And this is true of the whole National Security Council culture. There's a wonderful book on it that came out a couple of years ago by James Peck, a sinologist, called Washington's China. It was the first scholarly book to go through the whole national security culture. And it's like reading a collection of madmen, you know. But it's it's very much worth studying, much more worth studying than most of what people study in their courses on these issues. Well, anyway, that's what do we do about Latin America? the one we just, nobody has, you know, it's our domain. Well, Kennan was pretty explicit about that too. He said in Latin America we should prefer police states. The reason is, and he said that harsh government measures of repression should cause no qualms as long as the results are on balance favorable to our interests. In particular, as long as we guarantee the protection of our resources. Our resources happen to be somewhere else, but that's a historical accident. They're our resources, and we have to protect them. And if you have to do it by the mailed fist, okay, that's the way you do it. As I say, he was removed. There is a long, ugly history. There's no time to go through it, but the Cold War history essentially follows this pattern. The Cold War was a kind of a tacit compact between the superpower and the smaller power, the United States and Russia. The compact was that the United States would be free to carry out violence and terror and atrocities limitless in its own domains, and the Russians would be able to run their own dungeon without too much U.S. interference. So the Cold War, in effect, was a war of the United States against the Third World and of Russia against its much smaller domains in Eastern Europe. And the events of the Cold War illustrate that. Each great power used the other's threats as a pretext for repression and violence and destruction, the United States way more than Russia, if you look at the record, reflecting their relative power. But that's essentially the picture. You can see in fact, for the United States, the war was basically a war against, the Cold War was a war of, basically a war against independent nationalism in the Third World, what was called radical nationalism. Radical means doesn't follow orders. This constant struggle against radical nationalism, in particular a leading thesis all the way through, is that even the smallest place, if it becomes independent, is a serious danger. It's what Henry Kissinger called a virus that might infect others, like even a tiny place, you know, Grenada or something. If it has successful independent development, others might get the idea that we can follow, the rot will spread, as Acheson put it, so you got to stamp it out right at the source. It's not a novel idea. Any mafia don will explain it to you. The Godfather does not tolerate it when some small storekeeper doesn't pay protection money. Not that he needs the money, but kind of like a bad idea. Others might get the idea. And in particular, small, weak countries we have to crush them with particular violence so that others, because there it's easy, you know, nobody can stop you, and others get the point. That's a large part of international affairs, right to the present. Well, to learn about what the Cold War was about, the obvious place to look is what happened when it ended. Okay, so November 1989, the Berlin Wall fell, Soviet Union soon collapsed. So what did the United States do? How did it react? I mean, the pretext for everything that had happened in the past was, you know, the Russian monster, the monolithic and ruthless conspiracy attempting to take over the world, as John F. Kennedy called it. Well, now the monolithic and ruthless conspiracy was gone. So what do we do? Well, it turns out what we do is exactly the same thing, but with different pretexts. And that was made clear instantly. A couple of weeks after the Berlin Wall fell, the United States invaded Panama, killing unknown numbers of people. We don't count our victims, according to Panamanian human rights groups, maybe a couple of thousand people, bombing the slum, El Churio slum. The Panamanians take this seriously. In fact, last December, they once again declared a national day of mourning referring to the invasion. I don't even think it made the newspapers here. I mean, when you crush ants in your path, you don't pay much attention to their, what they may have to say about it. But they invaded Panama, had to veto some Security Council resolutions. The point of the invasion was to kidnap a kind of a minor thug, Noriega, who was kidnapped, brought to the United States, tried, sentenced, long sentence, a sentence for crimes that were real, but he had committed them when he was on the CIA payroll, almost without exception. small footnote. But for that, we had to invade Panama and kill however many people it was, a couple of thousand probably, and install a government of bankers and narco traffickers, that drug trafficking shot up and so on. But a successful invasion and applauded here. It was kind of a footnote to history. That's the kind of thing the U.S. does in its domains all the time. But it was a little different. For one thing, the pretexts were different. This time it wasn't we were defending ourselves against the Russians. It was we were defending ourselves against the Hispanic narco traffickers who were going to come and shoot up our kids and destroy the country and so on. And in fact, Noriega was a minor narco trafficker who had mostly been working for the CIA. But he became unacceptable when he started dragging his feet on following orders, like he didn't participate enthusiastically enough in the U.S. terrorist war against Nicaragua and so on. So he obviously had to go. This is George Bush the First. Right after the early 1990, he gave his new budget request. There was a new national security strategy. And they described what the post-Cold War world would be. Turns out, exactly as before. We still have to have a huge, massive military force, but we have to maintain what they called the defense industrial base. That's a euphemism for high-tech industry. And, for the public and so on, you talk about our belief in free trade and free enterprise and so on. But anyone who knows anything about the U.S. economy knows it's based on the state, extensively on the state sector. High-tech industry is very largely within the state sector, and it's under a government, it's under typically under a Pentagon cover as long as it's electronics based. So, and that's called the defense industrial base. So we have to maintain the huge public subsidy to high tech industry called the defense industrial base. We have to have a massive military, but it has different targets. As they pointed out before this, we were aimed at a weapons rich target, namely Russia. Now we're aiming at a target-rich region, namely the Third World. They don't have any weapons, but there are a lot of rich targets there. So that's what we need the major military forces for. In fact, that's pretty much what it was in the past, too, but now it's openly conceded. We have to, with regard to the Middle East specifically, we have to maintain intervention forces directed at the Middle East. And then comes this interesting comment. We need the same intervention forces directed at the Middle East, where the problems that we faced could not have been laid at the Kremlin's door. Okay, so sorry, folks, we've been lying to you for the last 50 years, claiming we're defending ourselves against the Russians. But now that the Russians aren't there, it turns out the problems couldn't have been laid at the Kremlin's door, which is correct. The problems were independent nationalism, and they continue to be so. But now it's said open and clear because the pretext is gone. We have to also be concerned now about what they call the technological sophistication of third world powers. It's a really overwhelming threat. It's kind of like Hillary Clinton a day or two ago saying that if Iran attacks Israel with nuclear weapons, we'll obliterate Iran. The chance of Iran attacking Israel with nuclear weapons is somewhere below an asteroid hitting Israel, but it doesn't matter. It's a nice throwaway line. But that's the kind of threat we have to worry about. It's kind of like Ronald Reagan in 1985 strapping on his cowboy boots and declaring a state of national emergency because of the threat posed to the national security of the United States by the government of Nicaragua, which was only 2 days away from Harlingen, Texas. So we really had to tremble in terror. That's standard. It had to increase after the end of the Cold War with the main pretexts gone, and it has. This is all consistent with a conception of aggression that has developed through the period and right up till today. It's very lively today. Aggression has a meaning, but that meaning doesn't apply to us. By U.S. leaders, aggression means resistance. So anyone who resists the United States is guilty of aggression. And that makes sense if we own the world, you know, so any act of resistance is aggression against us. So when the U.S. invaded South Vietnam in the early 1960s under Kennedy, Kennedy said, we're defending ourselves against what he called the assault from within. And the leading liberal light, Adlai Stevenson, described it as indirect internal aggression. So internal aggression by South Vietnamese against us, and of course we're there by right because we own the world. That continues right to the present, so skip a lot of time because nothing much changed and come right up till today. So the big problem of the Middle East now, read the Washington Post a couple days ago, is the growing aggressiveness of Iran. That's what's causing the problems of the Middle East. Well, you know, aggression has a meaning. It means sending your armed forces into the territory of some other state. When the latest case of Iranian aggression was a couple of centuries ago, unless we count Iranian aggression that was carried out under the Shah, which we approved of, the tyrant who we imposed, conquered a couple of Arab islands, but that was okay. But nevertheless, we have to defend ourselves against Iranian aggression in Iraq, in Lebanon, and in Gaza, where Iran is carrying out aggression, meaning people there are doing things we don't like, and Russia isn't around, so we'll blame it on Iran. That's aggression. There's a lot of discussion about aggression inside Iraq, carried out by the renegade cleric, Muqtada al-Sadr. If you read the press, you might get the idea that Muqtada's first name is renegade. It's hardly a phrase that a reference to him that doesn't talk about the renegade Muqtada al-Sadr. Why is he a renegade? Well, he opposes the U.S. invasion of his country. Okay, that makes him a renegade or a radical, obviously. And that's routine. Nobody questions that. It's kind of like reflexive description. Condoleezza Rice was asked a little while ago in a TV interview, how could we end the war in Iraq? And she said it's a very easy way to end the war. She said it's quite obvious. Stop the flow of arms to foreign fighters. Stop the flow of foreign fighters across the border. That'll end the war in Iraq. Well, you know, if somebody was looking at this who hadn't been adequately brainwashed by a good Western education, they would collapse in ridicule. I mean, yes, there are foreign fighters in Iraq and plenty of foreign arms in there, namely from the country that invaded Iraq. But they're not foreign, remember? They're indigenous, because we're indigenous everywhere. That follows from owning the world, going back to the nascent empire. Spread. So therefore, we're not foreign fighters there or anywhere else. We're indigenous, and it's the foreign fighters who have to be stopped. Actually, the concept of aggression has expanded recently. Back in January, you may have seen there was an important statement by five former NATO commanders, which was reported. The big issue was that they had said we have to base our military posture on possession of nuclear weapons, but it's nothing new. It's always been true. It was strongly advocated by the Clinton administration, but in much stronger terms, in fact. But that was what was reported. However, it was interesting was, and the one thing that was new, was their expansion of the concept acts of war. They said acts of war against which we must defend ourselves by the use of nuclear weapons, if necessary, is using weapons of finance. Okay, so if a country uses weapons of finance against us, that's an act of war, and we have to be ready to use nuclear weapons if necessary. Well, 2 months after, in late March, the United States Treasury Department warned the world's financial institutions against any dealing with Iran's state-owned banks. Now, those warnings have teeth, thanks to the Patriot Act, a little noticed element of the Patriot Act permits the United States to bar from access to the United States financial system any country that violates its orders, meaning if a German or a Chinese or other bank tries to have dealings with Iran, they can be barred from the U.S. financial system. which is a cost that very few are willing to bear, and might, and it could, and is in fact a declaration of war, and by the judgment of the five NATO commanders, an act of war against which Iran is entitled to respond any way it likes, perhaps with nuclear weapons or terror or whatever, according to these judgments. Now, you'll notice that there's a serious logical fallacy in what I've just been saying. It overlooks two fundamental principles, which are the crucial principles of world order. The rest is footnotes. The first principle is that we own the world and Iran doesn't. So therefore, the principles don't apply to us. They only apply to others. And kind of a corollary to that is that everything we do is necessarily with the best of intentions. Now, that's a tautology. You don't have to give evidence or arguments. And that's a constant feature of the intellectual culture, almost without exception, across the spectrum. So, for example, during the invasion of Vietnam, I hope I don't have to describe it to you, but it killed several million people, destroyed three countries. It's just a monstrous atrocity. If you look over the, there was vast discussion of it, mainstream discussion. But if you look closely, you'll find that there was never a principled critique of the war. That was not permissible. Typical, just keep to the kind of left critical end, and the rest gets worse. At the end of the war, Anthony Lewis of the New York Times wrapped it up. He said, speaking from the left liberal extreme, that the United States entered the war with blundering efforts to do good. Notice, efforts to do good is a tautology. We did it, so therefore it's efforts to do good. So it's not saying anything. Blundering, because it didn't work as well as they wanted, at least. Worked pretty well, but not as well as they wanted. So we started with blundering efforts to do good, but by 1969, it was clear that we could not establish democracy in South Vietnam at a cost acceptable to ourselves. Well, established democracy in South Vietnam is on a par with some Soviet commissar saying that Stalin was trying to establish democracy in Eastern Europe. But that doesn't matter. It's us, so we were doing. But the problem with it was the cost to us. Okay. So that meant we had to sort of start pulling out. Well, that's the critique at the very left end. I'll take one more example. The leading American liberal historian, maybe the most famous historian of his generation, Arthur Schlesinger, who was at first a super hawk, like the whole Kennedy administration was, no alternative to victory in their invasion of South Vietnam, which is what it was. But by the late 60s, he was having second thoughts, and he wrote a book expressing them. And he said that, we all pray that the hawks will be correct, and hoping that the surge of the day, a big influx of troops, will be successful. And if they are, we will be praising the wisdom and statesmanship of the American government in winning the war. And he was aware of what it was. He said, leaving a land of wreck and ruin with its institutions destroyed may never recover. But we'll nevertheless be praising the wisdom and the statesmanship of the American government, and we pray that they're right, the hawks. But he said they probably aren't right. It's probably going to be too costly for us. No question about the cost to the Vietnamese, I mean, land of wreck and ruin. So therefore, maybe we ought to rethink it. Well, that's the criticism at the critical end of the spectrum, the dovish critical end. Then from there on over to the jingoist end of the spectrum, you have a kind of a debate. Could we have won with more force, or was it a lost cause anyway, and so on. It's rather striking that the population is out of this. So in 1969, the year that Lewis pointed to, 70% of the population thought that the war was fundamentally wrong and immoral, not a mistake. Try to find anything in the literature of educated sectors that says it was anything but a mistake, that it was fundamentally wrong and immoral. That's not unusual. Internally, the government was aware of this. One of the things that is not taught but should be read, because it's very illuminating, is the final part of the Pentagon Papers. Pentagon Papers are not declassified archives. They're stolen archives, so we know a better idea what they were thinking. Pentagon favors end in 1968, right after the Tet Offensive in January 1968, which convinced the business world that this is going to cost us too much. We better start winding it down. There was a request from the government to send another couple hundred thousand troops to Vietnam, but they were dubious about doing it and didn't do it finally because they were afraid that there would be an uprising in the United States, a popular uprising of unprecedented proportions, and they would need the troops for civil disorder control because of protests among underprivileged people, women, youth, and others who just weren't going to take anymore. Well, that tells you that they were, they didn't admit that they were listening, but they were, and they always do. They needed the troops for control, and they sort of slowly started backing off. Notice that you can take the rhetoric about the Vietnam War and translate it almost verbatim into discussion of the Iraq War. There is no principled critique within the mainstream. And nobody can, by principled critique, I mean the kind of critique that we would carry out reflexively and do when somebody else commits aggression. Say when the Russians invade Czechoslovakia or Afghanistan or Chechnya, we don't ask, is it too costly? In fact, it wasn't costly at all. It practically killed nobody in Czechoslovakia, Chechnya, after reducing the place to ruin. Apparently, it's functioning pretty well. In fact, if according to Western correspondents, if David Petraeus could achieve anything in Iraq like what Putin achieved in Chechnya, he'd probably be crowned king or something like that. But nevertheless, we condemn it, rightly. Doesn't matter whether it worked or not or whether it was costly for them or not. Or when Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait, killing probably a fraction of the number of people that Bush killed a couple of months earlier when he invaded Panama. But we nevertheless denounce it as aggression. You know, no, that's a principled objection. But when we carry out aggression, it's inconceivable. Yeah. And that goes back to the principles that I mentioned. We own the world, and everything we do is, by definition, good in intention. So the worst that it can be is what Barack Obama calls a strategic blunder, or what Hillary Clinton calls getting into a civil war which we can't win. In fact, Iraqis overwhelmingly blame the civil war on us, but that's irrelevant too. That's the level of critique, and it follows from from the principles that I mentioned, and it governs news coverage too. In fact, pretty openly. Here's John Burns, who's the dean of correspondence, most senior, most respected correspondent. In Iraq after a long career, he says that the United States is the prominent economic, political, and military power in the world and has been the greatest force for stability in the world, certainly since World War II. It would be a dark day if the outcome in Iraq were to destroy the credibility of American power, to destroy America's willingness to use its power in the world to achieve good, to fight back against totalitarianism, authoritarianism, gross human rights abuses. Okay, in other words, that's the framework of reporting. Reporting must be cheering for the home team. Nothing else is conceivable because of the depth of these principles which are instilled into people in the educational system and propaganda. You can't see the world in any other terms. So it's neutral, objective reporting to say we're cheering for the home team. And it's quite open. It's interesting that he said it so clearly, but he says that's particularly true, he says, in the Middle East. Notice it makes not the slightest difference what the people of the world or the Middle East think. That's not relevant. Or for that matter, what the people in the United States think. So the Vietnam War was benign efforts to do good, which were too costly to us, even when 70% of the population said that's fundamentally wrong and immoral, not a mistake. Population here is as irrelevant as the population in the rest of the world, unless you're frightened of them and you have to keep your troops here for civil disorder control. What do people think? Well, what people think we know from international polls that are regularly taken. They think that the United States is the most frightening, dangerous country in the world. Not John Burns' line. What about the, and there's overwhelming opposition to U.S. force, just almost everywhere. It's also true of the Middle East, and there's nothing new about it. So George, our current George Bush, after 9/11, asked, why do they hate us, and went on, they hate our freedoms, and so on. You remember that. What the press should have reported is that he was just repeating a question that President Eisenhower asked in 1958. Eisenhower asked his staff, why is there a campaign of hatred against us among the people of the Middle East? And the National Security Council, the highest planning agency, had provided an answer. He said the people in the Middle East, their perception is that the United States supports brutal tyrannies, blocks democracy and development, and does so because we want control of their oil. And then they went on to say, yeah, perception's more or less correct, and that's the way it ought to be. So therefore, there's a campaign of hatred against us. And so it continues. After 9/11, the Wall Street Journal, to its credit, conducted some polls in the Middle East. They didn't care about the general population, what's demeaningly called the Arab street. They polled what they called moneyed Muslims, bankers, managers of multinational corporations, kind of guys we like. And they found pretty much the same thing as 1958. They don't have any objection to neoliberalism or any of this stuff. In fact, they love it. But they condemn the United States for supporting harsh, tyrannical regimes, which it does, and opposing democracy and development, which it does, because we want to control their energy resources. By 2001, they had other objections, namely Israel's U.S.-backed vicious repression and dispossession of Palestinians, which is ongoing, and also the sanctions against Iraq. The sanctions against Iraq didn't get much play here because we don't pay attention to our crimes. That's crucial. That's part of the principle that everything we do is good. But they do pay attention. In fact, we know a lot about them, or we can if we want to. There were two directors of the oil for food program, supposedly the humanitarian part of the sanctions. Both of them resigned because they regarded the sanctions as genocidal, carrying out a huge massacre of the population. The Clinton administration would not permit them to transmit their information to the Security Council, which was technically responsible. And the media agree. The spokesman for the State Department, James Burns, said that, referred to Hans von Sponeck, the second of them, as he said, this man in Baghdad is paid to work, not to talk. And the press agrees and scholarship agrees, so they're suppressed. They knew more about Iraq than any other Westerner. They had hundreds of observers running around the country sending back reports. But you can do a Google search and find out how often they were allowed to speak in the United States in the run-up to the war, for that matter, since. Von Sponeck, who's a very distinguished international diplomat, wrote a book about it about 2 years ago called A Different Kind of War. I don't think there's a reference to it in the United States, let alone a review. We do not want to publicize our genocidal actions. But people in the Middle East noticed and didn't like it, and that increased the campaign of hatred among the moneyed Muslims, our friends there. Don't have to think about the others. But it doesn't matter what they think. The same is true of the invasion of Iraq. Iraqis regard it as worse than the Mongol invasions. The great successes, Iraq may never recover. I mean, the great success story of Petraeus is to establish warlord armies, which will probably tear the country up in the future. And also to turn, say, Baghdad. It's true the violence in Baghdad has declined, partly because there are fewer people to kill. There's been massive ethnic cleansing. And that's been accelerated by the Petraeus strategy of building essentially walled communities. It's a comment by Nir Rosen, who's one of the two or three journalists who actually reports seriously from Iraq. He speaks Arabic fluently, and he looks Arab, so he can get around easily, travels all over, not with armed guards and Abrams tanks and so on. He says, talking about Baghdad recently, he says, looming over the homes in the district he's looking at are 12-foot-high walls built by the Americans to confine people to their own neighborhood, emptied and destroyed by civil war, which the U.S. fomented, walled off by the surge. Sections of the city feel more like a desolate post-apocalyptic maze of concrete tunnels than a living, inhabited neighborhood. They're controlled by separation walls and, in fact, by the increasing use of air power, but a little quieter, so therefore the critics, having no principled criticism, don't talk about it much. Well, what does the public think about all these things? Well, we know about Iraq. The public wants to get out, but they're irrelevant. What about Iran, the next major crisis looming, which will make Iraq look like a tea party if they go through with it? There are opinions about this. There's the opinion of American elites, which you can read, say, in the New York Times or Washington Post or liberal journals and so on. They'll tell you that Iran is defying the world by enriching uranium. Well, exactly who is the world? Okay, well, we can find out. There is an organization called G77, 130 countries, includes the vast majority of the people of the world. They vigorously support Iran's right to all the rights guaranteed by the Non-Proliferation Treaty, including enriching uranium for nuclear power. So they're not part of the world, okay? Now, what about the American population? An overwhelming majority of the American population agrees with G77, namely that Iran should have the right to produce nuclear energy, but not nuclear weapons. So the American population is not part of the world. So non-aligned countries are not part of the world. You know, American population is not part of the world. Obviously, Iranians are not part of the world. So who's left? Well, the world consists of people who follow Washington's orders. You can't say it includes the United States, because the overwhelming majority of Americans are not part of the world. They oppose this, just as on many other issues. And that goes on without comment, you know, correctly, if we're cheerleaders for the home team. And that's the framework for discussion. Is there a solution to the crisis with Iran, which is extremely serious? If the U.S. goes through with its plans, apparent plans, like I said, it might make Iraq look like a tea party. Well, there are solutions, potential solutions. One of them is what I just said, that Iran should have the rights of any signer of the Non-Proliferation Treaty. Israel, Pakistan, and India also ought to have those rights if they sign the treaty. Since they haven't done it, they don't have those rights, but of course they're doing it because we say it's okay. But that's the opinion of the large majority of Americans. And the same large majority, this runs around 75%, says that a nuclear weapons-free zone should be established in the region, including Iran, Israel, American forces deployed there, and so on. Well, that would end the crisis. Is that possible? Well, it's supported by the large majority of Americans, but as I mentioned, they're not part of the world. It's Iran's official policy, but they're not part of the world. The U.S. and Britain are formally committed to it, in fact, more so than any other powers, for a very simple reason, which we would read about if we had a free press. When the United States and Britain went to war with Iraq and tried to find a thin legal cover for it, they appealed to UN Security Council Resolution 687, 1991, which ordered Iraq to get rid of its weapons of mass destruction. And as you remember, Britain and the United States claimed they hadn't lived up to it. Well, you know, you're all literate. You can read Resolution 687. It commits the United States and Britain to work to establish a nuclear-free weapons zone in the Middle East. Okay, so if you can appeal to it as a justification for aggression, you're compelled to follow its provisions. But to point that out would be really to break the rules. And you can, again, do a Google search and see if you can find anyone even near the mainstream who's ever bothered to point this out. Another way to move towards a solution would be to end the threats against Iran. The threats, if anyone cares, are a violation of the UN Charter, but for outlaw states, that's irrelevant. Again, the large majority of the American population thinks we should end the threats and move to normal diplomatic relations with Iran. Well, if these steps were taken, the crisis would essentially be over. So we can ask, who's defying the world if the world includes its people, you know, including the American people? And the answer is very simple and straightforward. Those who are defying the world are the ones in power in Washington and in London and in the editorial offices and the university faculties and so on. They're defying the world, but not Iran, not on these issues. And in fact, it's a serious matter because it could lead to total disaster. And the same is true on other issues. So the other major live issue in the Middle East is Israel-Palestine. Well, what does the world think about this? There is an international consensus supported by about two-thirds of the American population, supported by former non-aligned countries, supported by the Arab world, formally at least, supported by Europe, obviously Latin America. In fact, everyone. Iran supports it. Hamas supports it. It's for a two-state settlement on the international borders, with meaning pre-June 67 borders, with minor modifications. Who opposes that? Well, for the last 30 years, the United States has opposed it, and it continues to oppose it. And Israel, of course, opposes it, though it, if the U.S. would support it, Israel would necessarily go along. So the problem is right in Washington. This begins in 1976, when the U.S. vetoed the first Security Council resolution calling for a settlement in these terms. It was introduced by the Arab states, backed by the PLO. Actually, it even goes back earlier, to 1971, when President Sadat of Egypt offered Israel a full peace treaty in return for withdrawal from occupied territories. What he cared about was withdrawal from the Sinai, where Israel was kicking out thousands of peasants and settling. Israel, he didn't say anything about the Palestinians. They were not an issue at the time. Israel recognized it as a genuine peace offer and decided to reject it. They made a fateful decision, preferring expansion to security. Peace treaty with Israel would have ended security problems. Egypt would have ended security problems. The important question is what would happen in the United States? You know, the godfather. Well, Kissinger managed, there was a battle, a bureaucratic internal battle in the United States. Kissinger won, and the U.S. followed his policy, which he called stalemate, meaning no negotiations, just force. Okay, that set the stage for the 1973 war and on to a whole list of horrors since. And up till today, the United States and Israel have been leading the rejectionist camp. By now, they are the rejectionist camp, not the U.S. population, but the government. So who's defying the world on this issue? Is there a possible settlement? Sure there is, but it resides here. In fact, on issue after issue, the major problems happen to be right here, which is a very optimistic conclusion, because it means that we can do something about it. It's here that we can have an influence, not elsewhere. Brazilian ethanol is made from sugar. It's much more efficient, and it's much cheaper. And in order to keep the ethanol industry functioning here, the government has to, first of all, provide huge subsidies to agribusiness, and also to impose a huge tariff to prevent much cheaper and more efficient Brazilian ethanol from getting into the country. The technical term for that is free trade. Okay, but if it's so, it's a big gift to agribusiness. It takes plenty of land away from crop production. That means that there's a shortage of corn, but also of a lot of other things. You know, if land is shifted to corn production, inefficient corn production for ethanol, it's not being used for soybeans and peas and so on. So that gets reduced. Same happening in the third world. Third world countries that are, say, producing soybeans may shift to using crops that will be bought up by the rich for ethanol. And that's happening too. So it spirals, and yes, it's one of the factors leading to a very serious food crisis. Just how much of a factor that is pretty hard to estimate. So the drought in Australia is also a big contributory factor. But, you know, all of that's kind of irrelevant. We can't do anything about the drought in Australia. The one factor we can do something about is the use of cropland for fuel. And ethanol is not particularly efficient from the point of view of pollution or energy inputs and so on and so forth. So all across the board, it was, I think, a disaster, and it was understood to be anyone who thought about it from the beginning, and it ought to be terminated. If anybody wants to use ethanol, they should break down the protectionist barriers and the subsidies to agribusiness and use Brazilian ethanol. It's causing, all of this is part of a whole system of undermining third world farmers. So one of the big effects of NAFTA is, intended effects, is to drive Mexican peasants off the land. Mexican peasants cannot compete with highly subsidized U.S. agribusiness. It's kind of obvious. So slowly being driven off the land, it's going to get worse now that Mexico has been forced to eliminate all tariffs. And they flood into the cities, they lower wages, which is very good for U.S. manufacturers who are exporting production there. And then they try to flee across the border. So we build walls. You know? I mean, these things are all interconnected. Same with Haiti. One of the things that American cheerleaders are supposed to cheer the government about is that Clinton sent the Marines to put an end to terror in Haiti in 1995. That part is true, but there's a little more. The elected government, the Aristide government, first elected government in Haiti, was a populist independent government led by what we call a radical priest, meaning liberation theologist concerned about the poor. It was overthrown a couple of months later by a military coup, as anticipated. The U.S. had done everything possible to try to undercut it in those few months. The U.S. immediately turned to supporting the military coup, violating the Organization of American States embargo. That was under Bush 1. Under Clinton, the violations increased. Clinton actually authorized the Texaco Oil Company to send arms, to send oil to the military junta and the rich elite in violation of his own presidential order. In 1995, Clinton decided that the population had been tortured enough, and it was pretty miserable. I was there for a while. So he figured that's enough. We'll let the elected government go back, but on a condition. The condition was that they accept a very harsh neoliberal regime. I mean, drop all your tariffs, drop all support for local production, and so on. Well, the outcome was completely predictable. I'm not saying it in retrospect. I and others wrote about it at the time. Haitian rice farmers are pretty efficient, but they cannot compete with highly subsidized U.S. agribusiness exporters. So now Haiti's short of food, and you're getting food riots. Yeah, predictably. That's the consequence of following such policies. Again, it doesn't take genius to figure them out. It's kind of like an elementary school student can figure it out. And this is happening in many places. So your point is very significant. There is a major food crisis, and we're not helping. You're right that the war in Iraq is restrained by comparative standards. Killed a couple hundred thousand people, maybe over a million, may have destroyed the country forever. It's worse than the Mongol invasions and so on. Yeah, but that's restrained. For example, it's nothing like the attack on Vietnam. I'm not even close. The Iraq war has never reached the scale of Vietnam in about 1965. At that time, there was no protest. And there are a couple of reasons for that. One reason is that the American population is much more strongly opposed to aggression than it was in the 1960s. That's part of the civilizing effect of the activism of the 60s. It had a big effect on the population, on all kind of things. Support for civil rights, for women's rights, the environmental movement, the kinds of things I was quoting about the American Indians. Those were standard attitudes in the 60s, not even questioned. The kind of things that kids were reading in school texts, say my own children, in the late 60s, you couldn't find in the most backward, crazed part of the country today. It wouldn't be permissible. All of this is a civilizing effect. That's why the 60s are constantly condemned as the time of troubles, kids going crazy and so on. They committed a crime. They civilized the country. And one of the forms of civilization was opposition to aggression. So contrary to what is commonly said, protest against the Iraq war is far beyond protest against the Vietnam War at any comparable stage. At this stage of the Vietnam War, there was no talk about withdrawal. In fact, the first book on withdrawal was written by Howard Zinn, who you know, and it was, I think, 1967. That's a time when there was, you know, 500,000 American troops there. Countries had been torn to shreds, extended to the, and that could barely be mentioned because it was so far out. Actually, he asked me to write a review of it, which I did in Ramparts, because nobody would mention it. Well, now, at a much lower stage of aggression in Iraq, everyone has to say something about withdrawal. Maybe they don't mean it, but they have to say something, you know. That's a big change. So one reason why there is, why it's restrained by comparative standards is there's just way more opposition. I mean, after all, the Iraq War is the first war in the history of Western imperialism that was massively protested before it was officially inaugurated. And that's never happened before, not that I can think of. So that's one factor. But there's another more important factor. Vietnam didn't matter much to the United States. I mean, if the country was wiped off the map, the U.S. didn't care. I mean, Eisenhower tried to build up some support for his early stage of the war by talking about tin and rubber and so on, but that was a joke. I mean, Vietnam had no resources of significance to the United States. The concern about Vietnam was what I mentioned, the virus infection theory. There was deep concern that successful independent development in Vietnam might spur others to take on the same efforts. The rot might spread to Thailand, maybe to Indonesia, maybe even to Japan, which was called the super domino by John Dower, a leading Japan historian. Japan might have to accommodate to an independent Southeast Asia. That would have meant the United States had lost the Pacific War, which they weren't prepared to do in 1950. So there was a concern about Vietnam, but it had nothing to do with its resources. And in fact, that the concern was overcome just by wiping the place out. So the U.S. basically won the war in the 1970s. Didn't achieve its maximal objectives, but it did satisfy its basic war aims. You can't destroy Iraq. It's far too valuable. I mean, Iraq has probably the second largest energy resources in the world. They're very cheap and easily available. It's not like Alberta tar sands. You stick a pipe in the sand and, you know, the oil gushes out. And it's right at the heart of the major energy producing section of the world. That's a valuable asset, not like Vietnam. So yes, there's got to be a limit on the destructiveness. You can't destroy an asset that you want to maintain. And the U.S. does want to maintain it. Today it happens that I just took a look at the morning newspaper. Christian Science Monitor has a front page article on the opening of what's called the U.S. Embassy in Baghdad. I mean, the embassy is not like any embassy in the world. It's the size of the Vatican. It has 21 buildings. It's an entirely self-contained city inside the green, you know, inside the protected area of Baghdad. I mean, they're not building that in order to tear it down. The major air bases that are building, that are being built around Iraq are huge facilities, and they are not being built with the intent of tearing them down. And they're supported by the Democrats. They fund them. And the idea, it clearly is to try to figure out some way to establish a client government which will be able to function, but much like the government in Chechnya functions. You know, they're Chechens. They have their own security forces. Or like, say, the Vichy government under the Nazis. It was a French government. French security forces, you know, French police, French officials, and so on. The Germans sort of hanging around in the background. Actually, it's pretty much the way the Russians ran most of Eastern Europe. It was Czech troops, Polish troops, and so on and so forth. So try to set up something like that, the traditional imperial structure, but making sure that it's a base for U.S. power and that the U.S. controls it.